Testaments. If you got Bibles, let's get into the Word this morning. Looking forward to continuing. We're in the middle of a study, or actually towards the end of a study of the book of Luke, one of the Gospels of Jesus Christ. And as we come to this chapter, Luke chapter 21, you've got to understand how incredibly important what we're going to read here is today. It's a larger chunk of Scripture, so fasten your seatbelts, right? Put on your thinking caps, as our teachers used to say. Because everything the Lord talks about today is about His return, His second coming, and His coming to judge and His coming to reign on the earth. Let me just ask, anybody excited about Jesus Christ returning? Anybody looking forward to that? I always joke, preferably before April 15th, right? Never hurts. Wouldn't mind even today while I'm speaking. But you know, this, what we read today, is our Lord's own sermon on His second coming. And realize it comes at a critical time in the life of Jesus, and more importantly, for the disciples who would hear this. It's critical because in many ways, up to this point, and as the rest of this week unfolds, and remember, we're studying now in Luke 21, the last week of His life, known as Passion Week. So we saw the triumphal entry, and then we saw how it is that He cleansed the temple. We see how it is that He's been preaching on the Temple Mount. This really, in terms of the timeline, chronologically, is about Wednesday, what we're studying right here in that final week of His life. And so we know Wednesday is another day of teaching and what He says here. We know tomorrow, in terms of this week, Thursday will be when He's betrayed, when He is turned over, you know, when somebody actually, in the form of Judas, is going to betray Him. We know Friday He'll be arrested, right? And then he'll be tried five times in front of five different audiences, three of which are the Romans, or the Jews rather, and two of which are the Romans. Five different trials Jesus goes through until finally then He is crucified on that cross. All of that goes down. And so for the disciples who had all of this in their minds about Jesus and who they were following, this could really, as the week unfolds, look pretty abysmal. It could be pretty discouraging for them. It could look as if His life, His first coming, was a failure because they didn't expect this. They didn't know this would happen. Jesus told them over and over, but when all was said and done, this was pretty discouraging. And so you take these words that Jesus says here out of the gospel record, and it's pretty disheartening. But don't lose sight, because Jesus did say these words. Jesus shared, in spite of all that was going to go down, we know the world has not seen the last of Jesus Christ. Isn't that good news? The world has not seen the last of Jesus Christ. He is coming back. And He speaks of it in this chapter. It's a powerful statement made by our Lord. So let's read it together. 38 verses we're going to look at, or at least up to verse 30 at the end of the chapter. So Luke writes, some of His disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. So He's there at the temple, and He's talking about the temple. He's talking about the religious leaders, and the disciples remark, man, this is an amazing structure. But Jesus says to them in verse 6, as for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them, He says, will be thrown down. Teacher, they asked, when will these things happen, and what will be the sign that they're about to take place? Now stop, realize, for the Jews, the temple, it was the center point of their entire country. I mean, this was the most amazing place. We've got a picture of the temple. It was actually built by Herod, and Herod began construction of this temple in 20 BC. And he did it really to appease the Jews who didn't like Herod. He wasn't one of them. And so, with the ability he had, he began in 20 BC to build this, and it wasn't finished until 64 AD. How many years is that? Math majors, 84 years this temple was being built. It was one of the most amazing structures. I mean, this was emblematic of the Israelites and who they were and what they put their faith in, their God. And you know, these colonnades that you look at and all the way on the outside, those were 40 feet tall, and they were hewn out of single pieces of stone. And the gold that was in this temple, this picture obviously doesn't do it justice with all the light in here, but there are places where solid gold ornaments ordained this temple. There were vines with all the grapes, and some of those vines were as tall as a man, solid gold. This place was amazing, folks. And this people would come from all over the world to see this temple. They would come from all over the world to worship at this temple if they were Jewish. And then the whole outer court that you see is called the court of the Gentiles. So anybody, even if they weren't a Jew, could come here. And then as you move in, you've got the court of the women. And then you have the court of the men, the court of the Jews. You've got the court of the priests. And then you have that main tallest structure. That's the holy place. And then the most holy place, or the holy of holies, where the high priest would go in once a year to make atonement for sin. I mean, this place was amazing. And so you stop and you think, here Jesus says to these guys, not one stone will be left on top of another. Who does this guy think he is in terms of the hearers hearing that? How can that be? This was a massive statement that Jesus was making, because as we know, for Jesus, the temple and what it stood for had become corrupt, and Jesus knew it was coming to an end, the temple, and for that matter, the whole sacrificial system was coming to an end. And so naturally, like we all do, the disciples asked, when and how, right? When will these things happen, and how will these things happen? I mean, not one stone left. This thing is massive. 84 years. It wasn't done even when Jesus was preaching or Jesus was there. And as human beings, I stop and I think about their question, when and how. How often we're dogged by our desires to know the future, right? I mean, we have the same questions about our faith. When and how, Lord? Some of you are single here this morning. And you're wondering, when and how, Lord, am I going to find somebody to spend my life with? Some of your marriages here this morning are in disrepair. And you're wondering and asking, when and how, Lord, is our marriage going to get back on track? Some of your finances are in the gutter. And you're asking, when and how, Lord, are you going to bless us and we're going to be able to get back on top financially? Some of you might have children who have gone astray. And you watch them go and live life. And you're asking, when and how, Lord, are they going to come back to you as you pray for them over? Or maybe you know someone who's not even saved and you're asking, when and how, Lord, are they going to put their faith in you? We always want to know the future. It's natural for us as human beings. Think about all the ways, even today, that we seek to know the future. And there are different means. We have those funny ones, crystal balls, and somebody over a crystal ball looking at it. And we have tarot cards, people do. I mean, we don't believe in this stuff, but people do. We have horoscopes. Now, people who look at their horoscope on a daily basis or a weekly basis, whenever it is, hoping to find some answer to their life in the future. Even movies that we have, like Precog and Minority Report. We as people are fascinated to know the future, and here the disciples are no different, especially about this. When, Lord, and how will we know? And you know, it's not explicitly stated, but these guys were still wondering when Jesus was going to establish his kingdom on the earth, right? Everybody wondered when he was going to do that. They had watched Jesus cleanse the temple, and no doubt they wondered, when are you going to get rid of these religious leaders, and when are you going to get sit on the throne here in Jerusalem? But like everyone else around him, the disciples and all the rest were looking for the wrong thing. They were focused on the earthly and the physical. And Jesus kept talking about the spiritual and the heavenly. They kept looking for things concrete here and now, and Jesus, as you're going to see, shares things that are future and eternal. Have you ever heard the phrase, usually used in a derogatory manner? That person is so heavenly-minded, they're no earthly good, right? I mean, they've got their head in the clouds, and they're always singing and praying and doing these things, and it's always stated in a negative way. You know, come back down to earth and live life, dude. In fact, I remember when I got saved at 20 years of age. I mean, I was just blown away by the love of the Lord. I'd grown up in the church, but suddenly I was blown away with the love of the Lord, and this was said about me sometimes. Oh, jeez, Brandon, he's just kind of out there. He's so heavenly-minded, he's no earthly good. Well, folks, when it comes to the religious leaders, it's the exact opposite. They were so earthly-minded, they were no heavenly good. And there's a whole lot of people who live their faith like that as well. So focused on the stuff of this world that they don't have a mind for the things of God. And according to Jesus, it all plays out in the position of these religious leaders, their temple and their focus. They didn't get it. And here's what Jesus says to his disciples. When it comes to the temple and all its earthly glory, he says there's so much more than this. There's so much more than this Jewish religious system as Jesus ushers in grace and mercy. In fact, let's personalize it. How many of you are happy here this morning that as Christians, believers in Jesus Christ, there is so much more than just this world? How many of you are happy that when you breathe your last, and God knows when that is, he's seen your life beginning, middle, and end, mine as well. I don't know if I got 10 years or 15 years or 20 years, but I know where I'm going, and I'm so thankful that this world is not all there is. Amen? Can I get a witness, as they like to say? No, we're not a Baptist church. Never mind. Here's the truth, though. The disciples asked him when the temple would be destroyed, and instead of answering them directly, Jesus begins to tell them not about the future of the temple, but as you're going to see, he begins to tell them about his future coming kingdom. And like I said, we're fascinated with the future, but here's what we can never forget. It's an old cliche, but I like it. We may not know the future, but we know who holds the future in his hands. Do you believe that this morning? You don't have to know. I don't have to know what's coming down the pike 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, or even the Sunday at 4:30 with the Super Bowl. Who cares, right? But I know Jesus Christ, and I know he has my life in his hands, and I can trust him. And I know that my future with the Lord, according to God's word, my future is good because God says he has plans for us that are good. He wants to prosper us. He wants to grow us in all the things the Bible contains. And here's what he tells the disciples as we go on. Look at verse 8. He replied when they asked when and how. He says, notice, he doesn't answer the when and how. He says, watch out that you are not what? Deceived. For many will come in my name, claiming I am he, and the time is near. Jesus says, don't follow him. When you hear of wars and revolutions, don't be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away. Then he said to them, nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. This is Jesus talking about what to look for before he comes back to this earth. The disciples couldn't wrap their minds around that because he hadn't even left yet. But we can as we read it. So he goes on, but before all of this, all of these fearful events and great signs, before all of this, they will lay hands on you and persecute you. They will deliver you to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name. The name of what? Jesus Christ. I know you've already figured this out. You can talk freely in our culture today about God, about the supernatural, about Mother Earth, or Father Time, or all the different depictions people have about spiritual things. You can talk all you want, especially go to Boulder. Enjoy it, right? I'm kidding. We have people from Boulder in here. Boulder's a great place. God loves them. Here's the truth, though. You can say all those things, and no one gets their, whatever phrase you want to use, back of their hair in the back of their neck going crazy. They don't get wigged out until you mention the name of Jesus Christ. Sit down and mention the name of Jesus Christ with the group who wants to talk about spiritual things and watch the whole conversation go in a million directions. And we know as Christians that we too are persecuted for our faith. It shouldn't surprise you in the last days. Jesus said, blessed are you when you are persecuted for me. Blessed are you because in the same way Jesus was persecuted. I mean, it's something we have to know is going to happen. But he says in verse 13, this, the persecution on account of his name, this will result in your being witnesses to those that are persecuting you. Folks, we're not all called to be evangelists. We're not all called to be pastors or teachers. We're not all called to be missionaries. But we are all called to be witnesses for Jesus Christ. The Bible says, You and I need to be ready in season and out of season. The Bible says we need to be ready to give a reason for the hope that we have within. That's being a witness. You don't have to go out and be a gospel preacher, but you need to go out and live the truth, and people will notice. That's what it's all about. But he says in verse 14, make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourselves. For I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. Read that, spiritual gifts, words of wisdom, words of knowledge, prophetic words. You will be betrayed even by parents, brothers, relatives, and friends, and they will put some of you to death. All men will hate you because of me, but not a hair of your head will perish. By standing firm, you will gain life. Now, that sounds pretty ominous. And you know that he's speaking, first of all, to the disciples, to the first hearers of this, who would be persecuted for their faith. But there are several things we can apply to our life as well about the future and about his second coming. The first is this: many will claim to be the answer for the world. Many will claim that they are the way, but Jesus is the only one, so don't be deceived. And that's a hard one, because there's always been people who have claimed to be God. There's always been people who have claimed to represent God. There's always people who claim to speak for God. There's always been people who claim to know the way to God and be able to even replace God. You know, there's humanism today that stands in the place of God. There's a whole set of environmentalism that claims we don't need God, we just need to nurture Mother Earth. And I don't want to get into political things, and I never do. But there are many things that seek to replace God in our life, that seek to say there is no God. And unfortunately, many people listen. Now stop. Not my words, but Jesus' words. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me, John 14:6, right? And we know that's a pretty exclusive statement. We'd say it's pretty narrow. We'd say, and others people would say, actually, that it's pretty arrogant that we Christians have the only way. But stop for a moment and realize we don't say it, Jesus did. And then stop and say, well, you know what? Truth, by definition, it's mutually exclusive. You can't have one truth that says one thing, have another truth that says the opposite thing, and then have both of those truths be true. Either one is true and the other is false, or one is false and the other is true. Truth, by definition, is mutually exclusive. And so we have chosen to believe that Jesus is the truth. And by his very words, that means anybody who doesn't believe in Jesus doesn't have the truth. And that's a hard thing, and people are deceived. Look at all the other religions of the world. And trust me, I know people want to say, well, hey, as long as you believe sincerely what you believe, that's all that's required to get to heaven. Sincerity. But sincerity doesn't get you to heaven. Believing sincerely in something that's not true doesn't get you to heaven. According to Jesus, believing in him gets us to heaven. Amen? And that's what Jesus came to reveal, the truth that he is. And unfortunately, folks, people are deceived all the time. Know what Jesus said and know who Jesus is, and you won't be deceived. We've heard it before when somebody who wants to be who looks for counterfeit bills, $100 bills, what do? They study all the different counterfeits? No, the method and the means is they study the one true thing, $100 bill, and they study that $100 bill, and they know it inside and out. They know that one thing so that when they say something that's not true, it's easy. That's not a real bill. No, that's a fraud. That's a counterfeit, because they know the one true one so well. And the same thing is true for us, folks. The way that we're going to avoid being deceived in the last days is by knowing the truth, knowing who Jesus claimed to be, and knowing him the way that he desires us to know him, which is so closely. That's the way we won't be deceived. Secondly, Jesus says, things in the last days will get worse before they get better, but don't be afraid. Now, I don't like that, do you? I mean, I just flat out, things are going to get worse before they get better. We look at our world today, 2017, and you'd have to say some things kind of really aren't that cool, right? I mean, it's going to get worse. There's a whole stripe of religion that says it's our job as Christians or as religious people to usher in the return of Jesus by making this world a better place, by making sure that we legislate morality, and by making sure that we get in and clean up this world and eradicate sin. And as soon as our world gets to a better place, then Jesus will return. The problem with that thinking is it's the opposite of what Jesus said. Things are not going to get better before he returns. They are going to get worse. It is going to, as he says, be full of wars and kingdoms rising against kingdoms, earthquakes, famines, and pestilences. And you stop and say, well, we've seen that already. But Matthew adds something in his account. There's two accounts of this signs of the end of the age. Luke's version that we're reading and Matthew's version that you can read on your own. Home groups, you're going to look at this. He says, Matthew does, that these, all of these pestilences and wars and such, they are the beginnings of sorrows or birth pangs. These signs will be the beginning, just like there are signs of a woman who is about to give birth. Let me tread lightly here, right? Don't go there. But when a woman is pregnant, what happens? The first thing that happens, she gets a baby bump, right? Everybody likes to show off the baby bump. And after that, she gets massively hungry for every food that exists, right? I can speak to this. I have three children. My wife was pregnant three times. And so it's like, get me this and get me that and all the hunger that goes along with it. And beyond those things is there's moodiness, maybe sometimes. There's morning sickness for some. There's contractions as things get closer. And then there's more contractions and stronger contractions, and then what happens? The water breaks, and then what happens? Baby arrives, right? Anyone? I know a couple of people just had a child. Very cool thing. And what Luke says, or what Matthew says, is the frequency and the intensity changes as the woman gets closer to childbearing or birth. It gets greater and it gets stronger, and that's the way it'll be before the return of the Lord. For the disciples, things were going to get worse. In fact, for the disciples, they would all be persecuted and killed for their faith, save John. And even for us, we know that there is going to be certain persecution for our faith. Don't be surprised. Now, folks, he goes on to talk about Jerusalem, and this is important because for the disciples, they needed to hear this. He says very specific things to them in verse 20. He says, when you see Jerusalem being surrounded by armies, you'll know that its desolation is near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let those in the city get out, and let those in the country not enter the city. For this is the time of punishment in fulfillment of all that has been written. How dreadful it will be for those, it will be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers. There will be great distress in the land and wrath against the people. They will fall by the sword and will be taken as prisoners to all nations. Jerusalem, Jesus says, will be trampled on by Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. How do you think they like to hear that? How do you think that was received as Jesus shares those very specific words? The third thing that he says is flee Jerusalem when it's attacked for them then. And we know historically judgment would come to Jerusalem. And the temple and all of its leaders in the form of Titus, the Roman general, right? Who destroyed Jerusalem. He destroyed the temple. And we know historically when they came, they killed 1 million Jews. They led away captive another 100,000 of them to Egypt. 40 years later, all of this happens in A.D. 70. I mean, it came down and you can look it up. The disciples asked a simple question, when the temple would be destroyed. And so Jesus tells them not when it will happen, I like this, but what to do when it does. He says, flee the city instead of coming to the city, which is the opposite. Whenever armies were seen on the horizons in these kind of cultures, of course the people would seek and they would run to the city because the city had walls, the city had all the supplies, the city had soldiers, the city had all the protection. But here Jesus says, don't come to the city, flee from the city. When we go to Jerusalem, when we go to Israel, we go to Masada, the very place or one of the very places that so many of the people fled to, tried to hide from the Romans. And so, obviously this doesn't apply to us, at least not in terms of the specificity. But here's what we need to consider, and it's a question I have. Why doesn't Jesus tell us specifically when things will happen? I mean, he's telling them the temple will be destroyed. Why doesn't he just say, in 40 years this is going to happen, 70 AD, so be ready? And here's what I think really is going on and what it applies to in terms of our life. Why doesn't God tell us or Jesus tell us specific things about what's in the future? Because the minute he does, we put our faith in that instead of the faith that we should have in the Lord. We put our faith in those plans or the faith in those descriptions and those ideas instead of maintaining and keeping our faith in Jesus Christ. There's many times I've wanted to know, how is this all going to go down? Because I'm a type A planner. And God doesn't show me because I don't want to get my faith in what I think or the plan. I want to keep my faith in Jesus Christ, which is why I believe he tells us how to live instead of things will happen, when things will happen. The truths and the commandments Jesus tells us to live by are timeless. So no matter when things are going to go down in our future, Jesus has said, flee immorality, right? That's how we should live as Christians. That's timeless. Flee immorality. Don't live an immoral life. He tells us to trust in him. That's timeless, no matter what things happen in the future. He tells us, don't worry, instead pray. And how timeless is that and applicable to all areas of life, no matter what you're going through? Don't worry. God has your life in his hands. Just give it to him. You say, well, that sounds pretty simple. It is, but it's true, and it works because Jesus said to do that. You see, we learn to live by the words that Jesus spoke, and we don't have to worry about the time and the way things are going to happen because we trust in him. It's that old phrase. I even kind of shudder at using it, but I will. He may not come when we want him, but he's always right on time, right? You ever had something in your life that you wanted to go a certain way? I'm 45. I've had a lot of different things in my life that I planned a certain way. Didn't happen the way I wanted, but in hindsight, I look back and I think, thank God. Thank God he was in control because his timing and his way is always better than my timing and my way. Can I get a witness to that? It's true. So he says, flee Jerusalem when it's attacked. Not when, but here's what to do. Not when in our life, but here's how to live. And then he says, when he returns, we don't need to be afraid. Look at verse 25. There will be signs in the sun, moon, and stars. On the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring and tossing of the sea. He says, men will faint from terror. Read this. They'll faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world. For the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to take place, Jesus says, stand up and lift up your heads because your redemption is drawing near, right? There's what we're looking forward to. And Jesus says, here's how it's going to go down. We hear that and we think, yes! But according to Jesus, there are people who will see that and will absolutely have a heart attack and die from fear, right? These folks will know right away it was true. Jesus is real. Everything he claimed. Because, you know, today, think of all those who say there is no God. When he returns, they won't be saying that. Think of all those who have rejected Jesus as the only way to heaven. They won't be saying that then. Think of all of those who mock and ridicule us Christians as being weak and simple-minded in our faith. They won't be mocking then. What do you think they will do when they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory? Jesus says some will shrink back and will faint from fear because it was true and they didn't believe. And the reality is, folks, we believe in the truth. Every knee will bow, just like we just sang. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And the beauty is we can do that here and now when we put our faith in Jesus Christ. Now, in terms of tribulation and the rapture and all of these things, a whole bunch of different views. Preterists believe that the tribulation happened in that first century when the temple was destroyed. Pre-trib people believe that we're going to be raptured out of here before all of this horrible stuff happens, mid-trib, halfway, post-trib, we're going to go through it as Christians, and then the Lord's going to rapture us out. Some people say the rapture's never going to happen, that Jesus is coming back. And, you know, we could debate all of the different views. And I have my opinions based upon the scripture. I believe in pre-trib. I don't think we're going to be here for all this stuff. I think Jesus is coming back, and he's going to yank us out of here as the church and all the rest. But this much we can all agree on. Jesus says he's coming back. Jesus is returning. And no matter if people continue to say, and they do, oh, you believe Jesus is not coming back. That's so funny, they'll say. That's not even true, and all the different things. But Jesus is coming back. So read verse 29. He told them this parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near, which we're looking for. I tell you the truth. This generation will certainly not pass away until all of these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. His words that he's returning, all the words he spoke. So people look at this, and they talk about the fig tree, and Israel's the fig tree. And they'll say that as soon as the nation of Israel is brought back together, which happened in May 15th, 1948, then the generation after seeing that 40-year generation, that's when Jesus is going to return. And so you look at May 15th, 1948, add 40 years, when was that? 1988. And some of you remember when everybody said Jesus was coming back in 88, right? Didn't come back. Didn't come back in 98. Didn't come back in 2000, didn't come back in 2015. I heard all of the stuff about that with the Shemitah, and he's coming back. And here's the truth, folks. It's harder to be specific about one generation. I think he was speaking figuratively about the generation of man, about who we are. But he is coming back, and we can stand and trust in the words of Jesus Christ. And here's what he says while we wait. This is critical. As I close, be ready for his return. I know I'm covering a lot this morning, which is why I gave you that as I close, so you can really, okay, we're getting out of here. Verse 34, be careful, or your hearts will be weighed down with dissipation, drunkenness, and the anxieties of life. And that day will close on you unexpectedly like a trap, the day of his return. For it will come upon all of those who live on the face of the whole earth. So be always on the watch, and pray that you may be able to escape all that is about to happen, and that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man. And then Luke says, each day Jesus was teaching at the temple, and each evening he went out to spend the night on the hill called the Mount of Olives. And all the people came early in the morning to hear him at the temple. His closing words about his second coming to his disciples then and to us today is, be ready. Be ready and be watching. Have your life in a place that you're ready for my return. You know, and whenever we have to wait for something for any length of time, do you ever notice the longer we have to wait for something sometimes, the more that we lose interest in what we're waiting for? I mean, it's like me when people ask me, hey, Brandon, you want to go fishing? I just think, oh, you're kidding? I don't like to fish at all. I hate to fish. I like to catch, right? Fishing is boring. Sorry, Dre, I know you love fishing, but I'm with you in the catching. It's boring, and people go sometimes to fish just to sleep, or sometimes to drink beer, or whatever people do in the boat. But you know, it's so boring up until that little bobber drops, or the tip of the rod goes down, and suddenly, fish on, how fun, right? That's cool. But as I'm waiting for the fish, I mean, I say no because there's fishing trips when I've never had anything happen. I don't catch a thing. I get bored. And the more we get bored and have to wait for something, sometimes the harder it is to stay focused. And what Jesus says is, as you're waiting for my return, don't get bored. Don't get caught up in this world. Don't get lost. Don't lose interest. Be ready, because I'm coming again. And we have something to do while we wait, don't we? He told us in 2 Peter 3:8 and 9. Peter writes, but do not forget this one thing about his return, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise to return, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to what? The will of the Lord is that everyone would come to repentance, but that's not what happens. But the whole reason why Jesus hasn't returned yet, while his return is being held off, is because God wants more people to come to know him. And that's what we get to do as witnesses here on this earth, to see people accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, to pray for people, to be a witness and a light for people, amen? To have a church where we preach the word and bow our heads and give people a chance to respond to the gospel. All of these things are the things that we get to do while we wait for his return. But never lose sight. There will be a day in the clouds, we see him coming, and we're going to say, hallelujah. Amen? Father, thank you so much for the reminder, even here in 2017, as our world feels like it's falling apart. We're thankful that it's not. We're thankful that you're in charge, you're in control of our lives, and we're thankful that you remind us that you're coming back, that we can hope, and we can trust, and then we can wait on you. And Lord, I continue to pray while we wait that more people would come to know you. Loved ones of ours here this morning, as we pray for them, pray for their salvation, as we give people an opportunity even here on Sunday mornings to accept Jesus Christ, Lord, that we would be about your kingdom work while we wait for your return.